Yeah, funny that, right?
It is weird.
Yeah.
You've suffered through this many times.
Oh, no, this is good.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Are you...
I'm a little sick, but...
Oh, well, that's not so good.
Sorry.
It's okay.
I won't cough on you.
So are you enjoying to continue to be the presence of young America to all mankind, even though you're Canadian?
Wait, what does that mean?
You're kind of the hip room. You're the, you know, you're kind of the, still the person that people kind of look to for cool when it comes
no,
to young movie
impossible.
Stars.
No, that's impossible.
You don't think so?
No. I mean, I don't consider myself, I consider myself my nickname for myself is Granny. I'm like a boring person. I like go to bed early. I'm not cool.
You don't, really, have you ever thought of yourself as cool, or is this just a permanent condition of grannyism?
No, I don't consider myself cool. I'm literally shocked to hear that.
That's why the police are coming now to take you away.
Are
after
they?
You've destroyed your image.
Oh.
So,
yeah.
So it's not a cool thing to front a video game? That's just a...
Well, I don't know what it is. That's what's so funny about it. Because it's funny when you do press for something, that's when you think more... You get asked the questions more that, like, I'd never thought about. Mm-hmm. Like, for better or for worse, when I choose to do something, it's typically because I'm interested in it, and I'm interested in the character and the people who are making it seem cool, and I want to go and spend my time doing that and want to go on that weird adventure.
Mm-hmm.
And this was one of those times, and wasn't really thinking like, oh, I'm doing a video game, da-da-da-da-da. I mean, if you'd told me 3 years ago, oh, guess what, you're going to be in a video game and it's going to be one of the most challenging and fulfilling acting jobs you've ever done, I would have been like, you're drunk, like you're crazy. And it was. It was an incredible experience.
So did it come to you script first, like normal, or?
Yeah, it came just totally out of the blue. And it was one of those things where you're like, what the hell does that mean? I don't know what being in a video game means. And really, I hadn't played a video game in about 10 years. Like, I was a big video game person when I was younger, but I stopped at about 16.
Mm-hmm.
So I was sort of ignorant, quite frankly, to the world. Wasn't really aware of what games had become and the sort of technological advancement and what people were now doing with the medium.
Mm-hmm.
And so then, like any job, you look at the material. I met with David, and honestly, it was a no-brainer. In the meeting, I was like, I totally want to do this. Totally want to do this.
So I actually saw you in a promotional piece, I guess, talking about the fact that it was so challenging as an acting piece.
Yeah.
What parts of it were things that were uniquely challenging?
Well, motion capture was new for me, so that is just a different kind of performing. And it's hard, you know, you've no sets, you've no wardrobe. A lot of this, I did work with other people, but also I did a lot of it just by myself. I think, and then, you know, and you're so used to playing to one camera. Here you're surrounded by 70 cameras, which is really actually incredible, like so freeing, because if you are crying and you want to fall down, you can. If you know you don't, weirdly you sort of have more technological restraints making a film.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so
so the director is into all of that. He wants you to go where you want to go in terms of physicality.
You can do
like
whatever
that.
You want. Yeah, I mean, when it comes to the... Okay, look, there's very specific moments in regards to something the gamer reaches for.
Right.
Of course there's specific moments that have to be very specific in their action.
Mm-hmm.
But in the actual acting of the scenes, you're really so free. So free. And so free with your other actor because you're not going in for coverage. You're not... You're really just... It's like being on stage. Mm-hmm. And... you know, the most challenging part of it was shooting 30 to 40 pages a day, because you're doing a 2,000-page script. You don't stop. It's
a 2,000-page script?
Yeah, you're creating a 10, 12-hour experience, you know? And shooting, you know, the course of eight years of someone's life. And shooting, having to do multiple variations in not every scene, but in scenes. So no matter what the emotional intensity or complexity of the scene is, on top of it, you're shooting five versions and doing it not separately.
Like, right.
I give you the response, I take a beat. I give you the response, I take it.
Hmm.
You know?
So is that the method is that the different responses
Or just one after another.
Just roll one after the other.
Yeah, and so to just, to quite frankly, just to memorize the dialogue when it is not such a cohesive, linear way of telling a story in regards to, you know, because in the end of your five responses, you basically, it's basically a monologue, you know? So it's intense, but everything about it that made it challenging also made it just such a singular, intense experience that I can't think of in any other way you would have that as an actor. So it was very difficult in moments, but so much fun. So much fun.
So fun to challenge yourself in that way.
Totally. Totally. I loved it.
Is that what you want in general when you pick roles?
Absolutely.
These days?
Absolutely. I would rather be working nonstop all day. I would rather be just emotionally exhausting and physically exhausting and like sit down for like half an hour at lunch and then keep going until the day's done, then wait around all day.
So were you like that when you did Marion Bridge, or is that, has it changed a little bit over these years?
No, I mean, Marion Bridge was probably one of the most important films for me in my life, honestly. It was probably the first time that I think I really was like, holy shit, this is what I want to do with my life, despite having worked for 5 years. And I think I always want to be challenged emotionally and be so compelled by a story that I forget about everything else and just dive into it.
Harder to find those things? Or, I mean, you're working a lot. It's not like you're not busy, but...
Right. Well, no, and now I'm sort of, you know, I'm producing two things, so now I'm sort of focusing on that and developing things that I want to do and have the control of, you know, much more than you do when you're just an actor. That is very exciting to me.
Mm-hmm.
I love that I'm getting to do that now.
Do you like the idea of producing for some without yourself as an actor in a movie?
Sure, actually, yeah. I think it's been sort of, you know, it's so funny to say that because it's a very difficult job. You know, I think producers don't always get especially the very good ones, get the credit that they deserve to just like, you know, the intensity of how difficult that job is and the sort of moving parts that you're navigating and the financial restraints and the environment, you know, whatever, and figuring all that out. So I'm very new. So I'm just learning, but it's been kind of blowing my mind just how much I'm loving it. Hmm. Despite it being constantly heartbreaking and difficult, especially because both of the films both have two female leads. And it's not always easy to get films made with women. It's just the reality of things. So, but all you can do is keep pressing on.
So I assume Leanne and Russ are pretty good
Leanne
role models.
Leanne and Russ, I love. Love. Still friends of mine. I see Russ and Leanne all the time. I go over to Russ's house and have some mezcal and hang out.
And they manage to actually keep their integrity in spite of all the pressures of the industry. They've managed to kind of stay above the fray.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they're also just extraordinary people. Yeah, I mean, working with them on Juno is one of the best experiences I've ever had. And Russ, you know, has just continued to be an awesome person in my life. Someone I look to for, honestly, support in moments and really has looked out for me in a way that has been really, really moving, actually. Been a very, very important person in my life. I adore him and Leanne.
So do you have any urge to direct?
I do, yeah. Yeah.
You look like you're shy about it.
It's a scary thought. It's a scary thought, I think.
But it's an interesting, I mean, in terms of wanting to kind of have more control and kind of have your hands in everything, it sounds like that intensity is part of what makes you a happy person.
Absolutely. I think... Yeah, absolutely. No, I'm very, very interested and am planning on doing it. I just, I'm not going to say that it doesn't totally terrify me. But I think even with, I think it's because I'm close with a lot of directors and I just see how challenging of a job it is and how lonely of a job it is, too. I think it's a lonely job. I think you are... There's a lot of people who are doing a lot of work, but they're always doing it from their perspective and from their agenda for what their job is, whether it's the costume designer, the editor, the composer, the actor. God, actors. So annoying. And the director's the only one who's really looking at the entirety of the project and looking at the whole picture and sort of having to be the person that's pushing that forward. So directors that I'm close with who are friends of mine, I just see how it's a tough job. So and you're stuck on a project for a really, really long time, and I'm not used to that. I'm more used to it now with the kind of producing side of it, because it takes years to make things.
But you're not on quite as much every day as you are just when you're directing.
Exactly, it's totally different. Totally different.
You can have 10 projects going as a producer and as director. That's it.
Yeah.
So does it make it harder to do pictures like X-Men, where it's kind of a giant machine and you're one small cog in it, a wonderful cog, but a small cog?
No, and that's fine to say. I know that I'm a very, very small part of the video game. You know, that's hundreds of people have put. I mean, it's a lot of. I'm not going to say I didn't, you know, but it's hundreds of people who put in years and years of work. In the end, I'm a very, very, very tiny part of that project. You know, it's the same with Inception or an X-Men movie. No, different movies always present different challenges. X-Men's challenging in ways that are totally different. You know, it just and in its way is a totally fulfilling experience of bringing a character off the page that's existed for a long time that people really love, and all you can hope is that you don't ruin it for the fans. Really. Is who it's for. But, you know, making those movies is... I can't think of a cast that's more insanely talented that I get to work with, and also just such an insanely wonderful group of people. Like, when they say Hugh Jackman is the nicest guy in Hollywood, it's not a joke. He is the nicest person.
I think he took the crown from Tom Hanks at some point.
Oh, I didn't know there was a crown, but, I mean... It couldn't be a lovelier group of people. So every day going to set is awesome, and I also love things that are physical. I love, you know, doing Whip It and Inception at X-Men. I think it's because I was an athlete when I was younger. I love anything that's physical, so I'm kind of super into the big scale action stuff. Like, I'm supposed to be doing a movie with Fox that's like a big, you know, quite amazing script, but very action driven. Thrilled about it. I just would love to be an action hero.
You're ready to put the suit on at any time.
Yeah, I am.
Well, it's funny because your career certainly has gone from, you know, even Juno, which ended up being a big hit, was a tiny movie.
Tiny.
It started.
Yeah.
And most of your career was that.
Mm-hmm.
And now people think of you as Inception, they think of you as X-Men, they think of these big things.
Mm-hmm.
But really you're an indie actress to a great extent.
Yeah, I'm used to... And I, you know, and I grew up making movies in Canada where there's no money for movies, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I am mostly used to, and I love. And I love being able to go from something like Inception. It always has worked out. I remember shooting the first X-Men movie, and then I shot a Bruce McDonald movie in Canada called The Tracy Fragments that was probably like an $800,000 budget, you know? And the same after I shot Inception, I made a movie called Super with Rain Wilson, which was, you know, maybe a $2 million budget. And I love being able to do that because...
And I still say you should have got an Academy Award nomination for that movie.
Oh, well, very sweet.
She's one of the great characters, I think, of all time. She's complete...
Wow. Oh, wow.
I mean, for me, she was like, Rain is great in it, and all that's fun.
Oh.
But that character was so brilliantly nuts.
Oh, thanks, man. That's a nice thing to say.
She sticks with me.
It was fun. That was fun. So I love being able to do that, you know, and... again, both forms of filmmaking, because really they're just so different, you know? Yet they present different challenges and different, you know, every job's always different.
So not a big consideration when you decide to do something?
What?
Big, small?
But, oh, no. It's always like...
Video game?
No, it's always the work and the character. And, you know, this... I hate that I have to say female protagonist, but because that is... There is such gender inequality in film and video games. The fact that this female protagonist was so incredibly strong, and but also vulnerable and dealing with a lot of difficulty and sadness and incredibly complex and very real character. I mean, let's get real. You and I can agree, as I'm sure everyone else can, that I do not look like Lara Croft. And I was really excited about the idea that this girl was going to exist, whether I had the fortune of being her or not. I would have just been thrilled that someone had written this character.
When I saw you, her, swinging that bat, I was like, wow.
When you saw what?
You swinging that bat. I was like, wow, that's pretty good. She's pretty good with a bat.
Mm-hmm.
You better watch out.
Yeah, she's a badass.
So do you have a bat on set, or is that just a little piece of foam or something that you're swinging around?
Yeah, it's typically, basically anything you see is not real. It's been cardboard or a chair or a wood block. Yeah, it's all nothing real.
So today's opening day.
Uh-huh.
Of your video game.
I know, it's weird, man.
Do you have opening day jitters? Do you think about things like that or worry about
it? I really don't. Maybe I should, but I don't, to be honest with you. I know this might sound cheesy and it might sound like bullshit, but what I love to do is the doing of it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what makes me the most happy. And when someone wants me to make something with them, I'm always just like humbled and stoked and grateful to be a part of whatever it is I'm doing. And I don't really think about that. I never choose a job and think like, oh, no one's gonna see this, or, oh, this is gonna be a hard movie to sell. Maybe I should. I'm sure other people think about that more, and they're not wrong to. It's just not how my brain works. I just want to do stuff that intrigues me, that's compelling, because if I don't, I'm going to be bored and depressed, and I became an actor because I love to act, so that's sort of the most important thing to me.
So, real life, Ellen, you were talking about before, the politics of all of this and the female protagonist of all of this. Mm-hmm. Do you have to be careful, do you think, of beating those drums or being political? Or, I mean, you're on Twitter, you have often funny and interesting things to say about all kinds of things.
I always get myself in trouble,
Is that, is that something you're conscious of, or is there somebody tapping on your shoulder going, stop it already?
No one's telling me stop it. I mean, I find it funny because isn't that what Twitter's for? And I'm a person. I think the funny thing is when you're an actor, people, maybe they forget that you're also just a person. Mm-hmm. And I'm a person who has opinions like anybody else, so sometimes I say them. And I don't think that I'm even right. I don't think that what I say fucking matters or is important. Of course not. I'm just anyone else who's on these formats. But because, maybe you're a public person, people freak out at you. And that's fine. It's just the way that it is. But I think what's funny is, like, when you're an actor and you don't ever talk about anything, then you're like vapid and self-involved.
Mm.
And then when you do, it's like, shut up, actor. You're just an actor. And it's like, well, I'm a person with other interests too. But whatever.
Were you not chill? You know, it's not
maybe
like you're
I'm just
out
an
there.
Annoying loudmouth. What?
Well, no, but I mean, you're not that they're like selling an agenda or you know.
No, I have
politicking.
What? No, I have no agenda whatsoever. I mean, I think I believe in being progressive, and would love there to be more roles for women. And that being said, you know, minorities, you know, and a wider range of storytelling in that regard. I don't think that that's a radical thing to say. Or radical to have a feminist perspective. I don't think I'm that radical with what I think.
I've had this strange theory this week about the idea that we now have more communication than ever with more people through Twitter and Facebook and God knows what.
Mm.
And yet, at the same time, somehow it's become more impersonal in
a
way. But people take it extremely personally when they feel it's about them.
Oh,
like people get really angry, or like everything is kind of like impersonal, floating out there. There's so much of it.
Yeah, well, it is so impersonal. What always blows my mind is like, and look, I really have no, I'm not being like, I have no problem with it. But like when someone literally goes on Twitter to consciously send something to me that is really mean, and probably like the beginning of Twitter, for example,
mm-hmm.
you're really like, huh, you know, or says something like really just awful to you. Now I could give a shit. It's funny. And I'm like, oh, you're a sad person. But it is kind of mind-blowing to be like, wow, you really feel okay about... There's such a disconnect here that despite this is direct... Despite you doing this, so I will see it. Mm-hmm. And despite writing something so awful, I mean, now you're... Now I'm just like, it's funny. But it's amazing. It's amazing the sort of meanness. That being said, that's like 1% of what you see. You know, so.
Well, and sometimes there's overwhelming kindness. That's another thing. That's the other side of it is like.
It's mostly people who are supportive, and interested and excited and, you know, so it's both things, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah, and then there's that fuzzy middle.
And then there's the fuzzy middle, yeah.
And sometimes you're just saying something funny, because you're saying something funny.
Yeah.
People forget that's possible.
Yeah, or people disagree with you, which is like, totally, you know? Yeah. I'm sure people would wildly disagree with a lot of the things that I think, because I'm, you know, a communist from Canada.
I'm always thrilled to be engaged in a disagreement. I'm not thrilled to have it become personal.
Sure.
That's what it's, for me, that's the line, is like, you know, as soon as it becomes, well, you're always an idiot who'll think that kind of thing,
yeah,
as opposed
to
I disagree about the debt ceiling.
Yeah, you know, sure. Yeah.
Completely different tone.
Yeah, no, I'm happy. I'm happy to read books that I disagree with and to be, you know, it's, that's, and to have information, new information, be willing to change how you see things, you know, that's what life is, and be open to that.
So do you get nervous on an opening day of a movie?
Mm-mm. No, I really don't. I don't look at reviews.
Did you ever look at your review looker at any point, or do you just stop?
No, I'm not say that I've never have, but right. I just never really, it doesn't really occur to me. Not that I think I would have a problem reading a bad review. I've read bad reviews. Someone's wrote...
Has Friend sent.
Yeah, I've read bad reviews about me or a performance. And typically I'm like, they have a good point. Like, I don't care if someone writes a bad review about what I've done. I don't... That's... Everyone is going to feel differently about seeing something. Especially the things that I sort of love doing the most tend to be... I mean, other than Juno obviously did pretty well critically. But... some things I've done that I love, such a polarized response. Like, just so, such a polarized response. And that's typically because it is jabbing someone somewhere.
Yeah, it sounds like that's something you would like, actually.
I do like that. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But no, I don't really. I mean, when I really care about the people I've worked with, director, writer, I typically care more about it doing well for them. I don't have much. I mean, look, if I direct something... or I produce something, it will probably be different, quite frankly. I feel like when you're an actor, I do what I can. I always give 110%, and I hope the people are happy that I've worked with, and you hope it works in the movie, but a lot of it's out of my hands. You know, I'm not in the edit. I'm not, you know, so... and it doesn't feel like my project. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just a small part of a pretty big puzzle. And but when the movie comes out that I've produced or directed and it gets bad reviews, I'd probably have a moment. I'm not gonna lie. I don't know if I'm that evolved. I'd probably be pretty devastated.
I'm not sure anybody is.
But I'm gonna work very, very hard to make sure that the projects turn out well.
It's hard when somebody tells you your kid is ugly. It's not...
when someone tells you your kid's ugly? Yeah. My poor parents had that all the time.
Oh, God. But you know what I mean. Yeah. It's, you know, when you've done all that work for all those years and all those people coming together.
Yeah.
And particularly when the experience was good.
Yeah.
I think it must be even harder.
Yeah. So.
So is the celebrity part, are you just not feeling it these days? Or are you feeling like you're comfortable with it now? Or is it hard part of the job?
No, I don't really think about it that much. I mean, you think about it a little when, like, you know, you, like, walk out of therapy and someone's taking your picture. But, or you come out of Whole Foods and, you know, whatever. But
but they don't really care that you're a therapist. They just want to know that your butt crack is showing or something.
Right, right, right.
Sell
right.
it for $20,000.
Yeah. Or whatever the crazy shit that they, you know, I mean, I don't even think about it. I'm such a boring person. I don't know why they would be ever interested in me. And I just don't feel like I'm that, you know. Other people have to deal with it on a level that I don't have to deal with it, just because I make tiny movies and...
And a few big movies. I mean, there may be a little movies, noise guess, around again.
But I feel like I... it's not... It doesn't really affect me that much. I don't think about it that much. I just sort of live my life and don't really think about it.
Until press asks you about it.
Until press asks me about it, or I'm like dating someone who I'm not dating. You know, that kind of shit.
Right.
Yeah.
So have you played yourself yet?
Uh-huh.
So how was that experience?
It's unusual. But again, it's the same thing. I'm such a tiny part of this project that when I sit down and play it, I'm experiencing something that... It's so cool to experience, because I was, like, sitting on a box next to Willem and, like, pretending we were in a car. And, like, you're seeing the scene, and it's wild to watch that, watch how it's all come together. And at first, it's trippy, but, you know, half an hour into it, I was, like, on the edge of the couch, so... Mm. I'm playing it and I'm digging it. I hope that doesn't sound horribly self-involved. I mean, I forget that it's me, you know?
You have the experience with your movies as well? The good ones? The ones you like?
The ones I like? Yeah, I mean, I feel like same thing. I'm a tiny part of these things, you know? Mm-hmm. And I'm always excited to see how it came together. Yeah, sometimes you love things more than you like other things. That's just the nature of what we do.
But when you see the movie, a movie, Inception or whatever, you're just having the experience of seeing the movie.
Totally. And
that,
like, that's
Chris
the
put
same.
Together.
Yeah, that's the same. It's like, you know, I'm walking in Paris and pretending that I'm like flipping the world upside down. And then when you actually get to watch that in a film, it's just as exciting as anyone else in the room, because I haven't seen that, you know? So, I mean, I loved making that movie and I love Chris and loved watching how that came together. I think that movie's so rad.
So do you ever get the advice to get cockier as you become a producer, that you have to
become cockier?
Get a hard edge,
right,
and be a tough guy?
Cockier, hard edge.
No, they don't sound like you, but yeah, you're a producer now.
Yeah, I think what is funny is I can be kind of in my every life, like, pretty passive and like, oh yeah, whatever, man, yeah, life's cool, you know, like little, just sort of like let it flow. And in that world, in that room, and when I have that hat on, I'm not like that at all. I'm much more intense about what I want and don't want and what needs to happen and that kind of thing. So I think I am actually really liking that experience. I think it makes me feel, and I think it kind of timed out perfectly, to be honest with you, because I feel like I have been doing this for a decent amount of time since I was a kid, so sure, I know a little bit, but it's funny, it was actually watching, like, you know, Brett Marling, who made, you know, produced Another Earth and Sound of My Voice in the East, and sort of, and not like, oh, I'm an actress and I'm also a producer, like, very much a producer and very, very good, and kind of watching her and seeing what she's done has actually been really inspiring and made it feel all much more possible, and not just that you'd be treated like the actor who's decided she wants to produce. And I feel it's very much involved and super excited about
the stuff that
I'm developing.
It sounds like it's empowering to you, in part because it's not about you. When you get into that room and it's about the work of producing.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not about your ego, it's about trying the project's ego.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, I think I would love to always forget about myself, you know. So, I mean, I think that's what acting is, a big part of it. Mm-hmm. Letting go of yourself and stepping into someone else's world. And why doing press is funny, because you're sort of forced to talk about yourself a bit and it's awkward. But I think when it really is about the work, about all the moving pieces, about finding the other actor, finding the perfect writer, working on the script, I mean, all of that is just so much fun to me.
It sounds like it's a really nice step. Like you're, it you know, is. Going to the next generation of your life.
I hope so. If it works out.
Yeah. Or if it doesn't, you'll find the next script and the next project.
Yeah.
It sounds like you're pretty determined to make it work out.
Oh, very much. And it will. I think both things will happen.